Welcome to secondary steel making course. Today I am going to introduce another topic in unit 3, that is inclusion engineering, or we will call it as a clean steel technology. What are the main objectives of this particular topic are, if you do not remove the inclusions formed after deoxidation, desulfuration, such as oxide inclusion and sulfide inclusion, what it happens? It leads to degradation of mechanical properties as well as corrosion resistance. So you need to remove. If not removed, this thing will happen. Similarly, this particular things are in terms of non-metallic inclusions. These particular inclusions mostly we usually observe oxide form or to some extent sulfide form. These things removed as deoxidation process, as desulfuration process, which are the part of secondary steel making units. Even then, some oxides dissolves in the steel before continuous casting. The process adapted tundish steel technology. In the tundish, those oxides dissolved in the molten metal will be allowed by using flow modifiers, flow controls and dams, weights and pouring basin by using different technology in the tundish. By maintaining the residence time, nominal residence time, you modify or you allow by using these flow controlling techniques, float these particular oxide and sulfides. If it remains at this stage or allowed to the float to the top of the tundish vessel and removed. And coming to this particular process, as other name, as I mentioned, clean steel technology. Why it is called clean? Because that particular steel, after continuous casting, the treatment which was taken, carried out in tundish, which was aimed to free from inclusions. That is why that particular steel in the form of billet, bloom and slab is called clean steel. And this particular, for making the steel clean steel, one need to care about few things, such as those particular prevention methods. Prevention is better than cure. You need to prevent the reaction interaction between air while casting, while deoxidation and desulfuration secondary steel making process, with refractory lining. From the refractory lining, if carbon is entering or oxygen, sulfur is entering and reacting, those things remains even in the tundish, even in the continuous casting mold, which remains in the steel as oxide and sulfide inclusion. So you need to prevent these particular things at a tundish vessel stage in the continuous casting process, and provide some type of flow controls and mechanisms, such as wear and a dam mechanism in the tundish vessel, allow these particular inclusions to float up and float up, so that you can remove those inclusions as slag particles is been removed. And this particular thing, why you need to understand these things and it can be removed in the tundish. It is also made cast iron and refractory lining is being given. There may be chances from the atmosphere while you are pouring from the ladle and teeming into the tundish, there may be entrainment or catching of these atmosphere oxygen, nitrogen and hydrogen. So those things, oxygen will form with the elements dissolved in the steel oxides such as FeO and Al2O3, SiO2. Those things remain as a inclusions and allowing those things to float up so that you can remove. These things are possible at the Tundish vessel in the continuous casting process. Now coming to the, let us know some classification of the non-metallic inclusions. What are the non-metallic inclusions? Mainly it is with compounds of metals such as iron, manganese and etc. with non-metals such as oxygen, sulfur etc. This is basic point one need to remember. And non-metallic inclusions forms separate phase other than in built, for example steel, austenitic grain structure, that is parent phase. The SiO2 oxide particle which is precipitated at the grain boundary of austenite. So that means which forms separate phase. And these particular non-metallic inclusions further classified in detail. For example, oxides. What are the oxides? With the simple oxides FeO, Al2O3 and etc. And compound oxides such as Al2O3 and SiO2, and these things are these things may be possible to formation of inclusions during steel making, in the secondary steel making process and continuous casting process by using the Tundish steel and Tundish homogenization, and with the developed and modern technologies you can avoid formation of these inclusions. Coming to the sulfides, FeS, MnS, CaS and such as those particular things, nitrates and carbides and phosphides, oxyphosphides, MnS and MnO, such as those things, carbonitrides, titanium and carbon nitrogen, combination of these things may form. So along with this particular elements such as titanium, vanadium and niobium, all these things are inclusions. But broadly it speaks about when you say inclusions are nothing but non-metallic inclusions, you do not mean that all these things are non-metals. It is combination of, as I defined, metals and non-metals. That is why you call it as a non-metallic inclusions. It doesn't mean that the inclusions are only oxides and sulfides. You realize to see in this stage there are many other inclusions forms. It either it need to be modified and allow it to the float up in the Tundish stage so that you will be getting the free from the inclusion steel, which is clean steel. And these particular topics, inclusion and inclusion engineering, the other names and alternative names of inclusions usually appears many questions in the GATE examination and Viva questions. I request all the students to please focus on this particular topic as very important with respect to future competitive exams. Now let me give you the simple glimpse of sulfide, sulfide inclusions. How does it looks like? For example, if you see in A, it is MnS sulfide, these particular particles, manganese sulfide particle. This is semi-killed steel. That means there will be 50% oxygen is remained in the steel. And this particular inclusions are round type 1 inclusions observed in semi-killed steel. And type 2, interdendritic, within the dendritic, these kind of inclusions
appear type 2 inclusions in kilned steel where the oxygen is negligible. Carbon is at large content in the case of kilned steel. And third one is angular type. At the angular moment, the inclusion appears. Type 3 inclusions, which is mainly formed with the sulfide, aluminium and zirconium addition is excess. Then these kind of sulfides appear, sulfide inclusions. And when the aluminium is added, there may be chances of at that stage, in the kilned steel, this fine sulfides distribute, fine sulfide particle distribute within the dendrite arms. That is why you call it as a interdendritic. Within the dendrite arms, it goes and sits, deposits, which is secondary phase, which can be recognized using the energy dispersive spectroscopy. What kind of sulfide particle it is, what is the parent matrix, it can be easily identified by the microstructural analysis. Please remember this particular point. Coming to the oxide inclusions, for example, alumina Al2O3, this particular alumina usually added to remove the oxygen dissolved in the steel. This particular Al2O3 forms as a liquid immediately in the dissolved steel and forms Al2O3, and it converts into the forms because of the melting point difference from the FeO and Al2O3. Al2O in melting point is higher. Immediately it will be in the form of semi-solid form. It flows to the up. So that particular floating of Al2O3, if it is solidified, that particular droplet form, it remains in the steel, comes out as in the continuous casting process billet form, Al2O3 sulfides, solid form Al2O3 particles. Another form is alumina dendrites. These particular dendrites, usually you will see in the continuous casting product billet sample, at that particular stage you realize to see alumina is remained in the steel. This is example microstructure for the oxide inclusions. Now let me talk about the typical size of the inclusions. From the microstructure one can assess. If the inclusion is called micro inclusion, it will be in the range of 1 to 100 micrometer. And these particular inclusions are beneficial. In other words, it has advantage. It restricts the grain growth so that the yield strength and hardness, mechanical properties increases if inclusion is micro inclusions. If it is macro inclusions, it shows adverse effect. These particular macro inclusions would also interact with carbide and nitrogens and in the form of solidified, which carried out comes through the billet. It remains just like alumina, solidified alumina in the form of alumina dendrites, which is harmful, which decreases the ductility. And these macro inclusions are greater than 100 micrometers. Remember this particular point also. Now, what are the sources of inclusions? Where does it is coming? During this particular deoxidation process, you usually add deoxidizers such as aluminium with interacting dissolved oxygen. This Al2O3 will comes up. If Al2O3 is remaining, instead of semi-solid, it can be gone off. If it is solidified, it remains in the interdendritic form. So that is nothing but macro inclusions, which shows adverse effect. And there may be another sources, the erosion process of refractory lining. Refractory materials also, basic refractories, acid refractories are used. In the basically the entire steel making process, the vessels are made up of refractory lining or refractories. For example, blast furnace completely refractory construction, and LD converter refract basic refractory construction, and there may be another chance of entrapment of slag particles, such as it could be the FeO, it could be the CaS, that may be remain in the finally continuous casting product. So you need to make sure that at the tundish steel making process, remove all the slag particles completely. Even then, there may be out of control of oxygen pickup from the atmosphere, but around 40 ppm of oxygen is allowed to stay in the steel. So that particular things need to be taken care. This particular mechanisms and formation of inclusions are divided into two categories. One is indigenous inclusions, just like deoxidation process, desulfuration process. During this particular secondary steel making process, these particular elements such as aluminium, calcium, with the dissolved oxygen remains within the steel. Finally, it comes out with the billet and bloom form while the continuous casting process. There may be chances of just like mechanical and refractory lining process, which is exogenous inclusion process, which comes out from the ladle lining, mold material, copper mold, which are used in the continuous casting. Thus particular copper nitride may form. Those particular things are the sources. So you need to know the knowledge of these things and avoid or control to the minimum level at the stage of tundish steel making process. Now let me tell you how does this particular inclusion nuclei forms. The basically, if you see it in the simple schematic form, this particular way the molecules are arranged in the liquid, this way molecules are arranged in the usually observed this particular thing in the solid. These particular things cluster together because of the temperature and pressure change, which is nothing but free energy. When the free energy of this particular thing is coming down, it starts form a nuclei cluster. All these particular four atoms or molecules forms a nuclei. This particular nuclei further grows. It converts into the form of a grain. Nucleus is converted into the grain. In another way, in terms of grain growth, observe that, assume that this is a liquid, these are the molecules, or assume that this is a nuclei, just like it is combination of molecules. After some time, this particular nuclei cluster together, forms small grains, semi-grains within the liquid. These are the grains distributed within the liquid. And after completely solidified, this is semi-solidified, completely solidified, such as billet and bloom, usually you will see these grains, which is one category of grains. If it is inclusion, it may be deposited along the grain boundary or over the grain or within the grain. With the, it could be in the form of dendritic form. Usually it forms a dendrites within the grains. This mechanism also one need to remember. How does those inclusions formed within the grain and these particular stages, how does it evolve? How does it grow? Let me talk about two examples. One is silica inclusions, the other thing is alumina inclusions, SiO2, Al2O3 inclusions. As I mentioned the mechanism, these are the atoms distributed in the liquid steel, and as the time proceeds, these particular things, these things forms as a arms for the center molecules. This is dendrite growth initiation, and further there may be breakup of this particular dendrite arm, so which is called dendrite multiplication will occur, and these things again it forms another dendrites. This particular nuclei forms another dendrites, and finally there may be cluster of all these particular dendrites multiplication, and finally it forms a small grain by the formation of coalescence, coming all these particular dendritic grains together. Then at this particular stage of coalescence, in the tundish, by purging the argon from the other side of this particular tundish, you can allow this particular modified inclusions from the molecule stage to nucleus stage to these forms, allow to float up, you can remove these kind of silicon inclusions. Similarly, in the case of alumina inclusions, these are the observed at the molecular and microstructure stage. This is how it forms in the case of alumina, this is different in the case of silica, and multiplication also and coalescence also, it is quite different. But initial stages, these particular things are same in the case of any of the inclusions, float up, so that you can reduce the inclusions ratio and finally you will get the inclusion free steel. Now after this particular completing this topic, let me ask you guys a simple question based on this particular inclusion engineering, that inclusion formation in steel making have advantage of grain growth restrictions such as micro inclusion formation, but in another case it shows adverse effect by picking up with the carbide and hydroids along with the inclusions, it remains in the steel, carry forward along with the billets and semi-finished goods which need to be removed off. Is it this particular thing is true from this particular section of the topic or not? Please give your opinion.